Hey everybody, thanks for tuning into another episode of Up In Your Business. Today we are joined by Brooke Coughlin, realtor, entrepreneur, overall hustler in my mind. We will get into it in a minute, but we're going to start here with 20 questions. You ready?
Ready.
Favorite color?
Blue.
Favorite snack?
Chex Mix.
iPhone or Android?
iPhone.
Left or right?
Right.
Pick a number 1 to 10.
5.
Favorite number?
5.
Coffee or tea?
Coffee always.
Favorite drink?
Margarita.
Iced coffee or hot coffee?
Hot.
Steak or chicken?
Chicken.
Oreo or Chips Ahoy?
Chips Ahoy.
Favorite vegetable?
Carrots.
Prefer to work from home or in an office?
From home.
Clean desk or messy desk?
Messy desk.
Your biggest inspiration or role model?
Michael Burns.
Last time you ran a mile or close?
A month ago.
Okay. Last time you... I just said that. Coolest place you've traveled?
Coolest place I've... Turks and Caicos.
Oh, that's cool. First job ever?
I was a waitress at my family's restaurant called The Lobster Nook.
Oh, nice. Favorite day of the week?
Sunday.
Nice. And favorite part of your job?
The flexibility and the fact that there is no cap on what I do.
I like that. That's a good one.
Endless opportunities.
Yeah. And endless opportunities, yeah. Yes.
For real. Chips Ahoy. Most people say Oreo.
Yeah, I was surprised.
I like both.
I had to think for a second.
Yeah.
Are you sick of seafood growing up in a seafood restaurant?
No, I love seafood. Shrimp, everything. If there's lobster mac and cheese, that's what I get every time I'm at a restaurant.
I love lobster mac. Yes. So good. Yes. You got to go down to Newport.
Okay. I'll go there after this.
Best lobster mac. Best lobster mac.
Awesome.
Oh, that's funny. So you said your inspiration role model is Michael Burns.
Michael Burt, he is the owner of our company, cool. And he also dates my sister.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he is like the 2023 Bill Gates, the 2023 Grant Cardone, under 30 years old. He's just a true inspiration that I work with every day.
That's cool. Because I was going to say, I recognize the name from your real estate group that you work for.
Yeah. You know, he was just an average Joe, and he's built his life into this incredible empire, and he was just a normal human being, so it's a big inspiration. Cool. To see if he can do it, I can do it,
right.
Anybody can do it. He had an interesting story that I won't tell all of it, but he sold a business for a lot of money, and he had this big chunk of money and said he needed to start getting into real estate, mm-hmm. start buying properties. And we were giving the old company that I was working for so much revenue each year that he was like sitting back, how come we're paying this company this month, a month, right, whatever? How about we open our own? So we took everything we learned from the old company and made our own, and it's been fantastic.
Love that.
Yes.
That's sick.
Yeah.
I like that story.
Owning the ecosystem, he likes to say.
And how long ago was that?
It would be a year in February. It was a year in February.
Oh, so wow.
A year
okay.
and a few months.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool. And you, not to jump too far ahead, but... last year, you sold a ton of real estate.
Yeah, last year I sold over 20 million.
20 million, right? Okay.
Damn, I wanted to make sure.
Thank you. That's I helped awesome. 47 Crazy. People purchase properties. And
that's sick.
It gets better because this year I'm on track for 40 million.
Damn. You're
doubling it.
That's so great. You hit something, you're like, okay, I'm not going back. How do I 10x it? How do I go
47? It's the Grant Cardone method, right?
Grant Cardone. Yeah, see, I didn't even plan that.
That's funny.
Oh, my gosh.
47 is a lot of homes in 1 year. That's like 4 a month.
Yes.
Is that all residential?
Residential. Most of them are residential last year, and then this year I'm dipping my toes into commercial.
Yeah.
And I'm realizing how much more I like commercial than residential. I mean, you take whatever you can get, but commercial deals, instead of doing like a $250,000 house, you're doing a $2.5 million house, or not house,
right, office
property or something like that. So the return is a lot higher.
Sick. I just over the past 6 months to a year, I've gotten super just fascinated by real estate. And so I've been listening to podcasts and just consuming a ton of knowledge. And there was a podcast I started listening to that talks about commercial real estate. And one episode was specifically with this commercial real estate agent or broker. Yeah. And she was talking about the comparisons between residential, and she was a lot of people find it intimidating compared to residential, but there are some similarities, blah, blah, blah. But it can be much more attractive, and like if you can learn it, it's like a
yeah. And awesome. Instead of doing, you know, five deals to equal $1 million worth of real estate, you can do one and make it $5 million.
Right.
You know,
right.
So it can be a lot less running around. Yeah. Still the same level of stress, if not more, because you're dealing with such large numbers.
Right.
But you can go a lot further.
Yeah.
I think, in commercial than residential.
And like there's so many terms I'm learning, like cap rate. That was the first one that I was like, cap rate, what the heck is that? And there's like percentage points, and then like I don't remember it all, but it was like certain percentage points means like X, and like it has something to do with the return, right? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
But real estate as a whole can just change your life. I remember I went to school to be a teacher, and I came from a family of educators, and I thought I was going to be a teacher for the rest of my life. I was going to retire at 60 with a pension, and I was going to be all set.
Yeah.
Until my eyes were just open to a whole new world.
Yeah.
And
you were a teacher, right?
I was a teacher. Okay. I was a seventh grade teacher for 3 years. Nice. I left last December, and I have never looked back since.
So it's a good change.
It was a good change. Yeah. I mean, don't get me wrong. I love the kids. I had a blast with my coworkers, but just the freedom and the ability to grow.
Yeah.
It's unmatched.
Yeah. Like teachers don't get paid a lot. And
Where they should. They should get paid a lot. But they don't get what they deserve.
Right. And like there's not, like you were talking about the opportunity for growth. Like there's, you don't really go that high, even if you stay in like.
It's could be the best teacher or the worst teacher, and you're still going to make the same amount of money. And you know, after each year, like, this is as high as I can go. You do get your weekends off. You get summers off. You get the vacations. But still, it doesn't equate to much. I remember, I like to tell the story often, that with teaching, I would be making $1,400 every 2 weeks. And now, like, I just closed a deal of $70,000, one deal, which was more than I would be making as a teacher for an entire year.
Yeah.
That's crazy. So I'm like, oh my gosh.
Right.
Why didn't I do this sooner?
It's wild.
But I think it also helps because I have that teaching background that, like, I teach my clients. I teach the agents that I work with. Like, I'll hold your hand through the entire transaction. You'll always know where we're going.
Right.
So having that background, I think, sets me apart from maybe other agents in the field who don't.
Sure. As being somebody who, like, does so much, like, you own Airbnbs, you own a cleaning business, you're an agent, you're an investor, you do flips. Like, when somebody asks you, like, if you meet a stranger and they're like, hey, hi, what do you do? Like, what do you say?
That's a good question.
That's a really good question.
What I was like trying to think of like how to, like the proper introduction. Yeah. Like, you know, what is that?
I would say all I'm an entrepreneur with a heavy focus on real estate. I mean, when I was in college, I started a cleaning business to have a little extra beer money on the weekends.
There you go.
Not beer money. I hate beer. Margarita money, wine money, whatever. And
booze money.
Yes. And I would
book money.
Dad. Thanks for paying for my education. but I would clean a few houses here and there, and you know, make my own schedule. It was decent money, and like 30 to 40 an hour. And I never minded, you know, cleaning toilets or sweeping floors. And then it got to the point where I was about to graduate, and I was like, I can't give up this cleaning business to go become a teacher. So what do? You start hiring people. Well, at the time, I had no idea what I was doing, wasn't even insured, etc.
Right.
And I hired my first employee, who was accused of stealing a diamond necklace day one on the job.
Oh, no.
You've got to be kidding me. Yeah. Like, I didn't know her from a hole in the wall, and I didn't know the client. So who's telling the truth here?
Right.
But I ended up having to fire her and restart. But I could have easily have just been like done with that.
Yeah, yeah.
But now I have a team of 13 employees. Damn. We have over 100 residential and commercial companies that we clean for. And it's a six-figure plus business.
That's based, just like on the side.
Yes.
And that's based out of Mass?
Mostly Massachusetts. Most Massachusetts. Yep.
Damn. That's sick.
Yeah. It's, but I owe like all of that to the ladies who work for me because they are unbelievable, and I couldn't do it without them.
Right.
Yes.
That's so cool to have started that like in college. And not with the idea of like, let me start like a really cool business. You're yeah. like, let me just get some like side money here yeah. so I can.
And it just blew up. Like, I don't yeah. advertise. People sometimes say, oh, do you still have your cleaning business? You don't post about it. I'm like, yes, I don't need to. It's to a point that it's just very successful. And could I blow it up more? Yeah. Do I have the time to? No. So it's good just where it is.
It's passive income. Right, you're just sitting there collecting, you know? Just, well, I mean, I'm sure there's day-to-day stuff you have to do, yeah. but
yes.
like you're not physically going in to do the cleaning.
No, I do yeah. sometimes, yeah. if need be. Like, we handle a very big wedding venue, cool. and they are Ocombe Wedding Venue. Shout out to them. They're amazing people,
yeah.
family-owned, and... it's such a good gig that I go and I ensure that everything is smooth. Like, that's sometimes cool. at 6 a.m. when my cleaners were there at 4:30, just like do my final walkthrough and then go mm-hmm. home and start my day. But
damn.
And fill in when needed. It's kind of fun. I don't. Yeah. I like that place, so that's I don't cool. mind stepping in there.
Yeah, and I guess like from there, tell us a little bit about like, I guess you kind of did, but getting into real estate. Like, when did you get to the point where you're like, I'm going to leave my teaching job and like, what was the mindset and, yeah, like getting that start in real estate?
That's a great question. So it actually ties in with cleaning. So I was going to give a quote at a cleaning, somebody's house. And I was walking around their house saying, like, this is what we do. This is how much they charge. Little did I know they owned a brokerage or they were high up in a brokerage. And they're like, have you ever thought about real estate? And I'm like, no. And they're like, well, you'd be really good at it. And I'm like, I don't know much other than looking at houses on Zillow, and they, which everybody does, yeah, right?
I do that for fun.
Yeah, it's fun. I do it too, 10 yeah. times a day. And they're like, here, take this course. And I'm like, I'll take my time because I'm teaching. I'm doing the cleaning business. Yeah. So it took me a long time to get going in it. It took me quite a few times to pass my test, which people don't typically talk about, but it's not easy.
So sure,
I don't mind saying it took me maybe double digits to pass up front.
Yeah.
Because nobody asks you that now. And no, somebody could have passed that test the first time, but be nowhere near anywhere exactly, in yeah. sales numbers that I am. So it took me a lot longer to pass. I got going. I liked it. And it wasn't until I was having consistent success, like within year two, where I saw the consistent deals closing yeah. each month, that I felt comfortable
yeah.
To even think about quitting my job.
Right.
And then Mike Burns, the owner of my company, who is this massive yeah. Businessman, he's like, I think you just need to make the jump. And when Mike Burns says jump, I say, how high? And put my 3 months notice into my principal yeah. and left Christmas break. And it's been the best decision of my entire life.
That's so cool.
How'd the people around you take that?
Oh, not very good.
Really?
I remember, well, I guess, what people are you talking about?
Like family-wise.
Family-wise.
Yeah, yeah.
Family-wise, they trust me, especially my husband. And my husband is, we're similar, but very
awesome
opposite.
Guy.
He's an awesome guy. I love him. Going on 1 year of marriage.
I can personally attest to that. I've met him.
He's a very good man, but we're very different.
Oh, so yeah.
I am the risk taker. I want something done today. He is more of a 9-to-5, makes a wonderful income and consistent. Like, yeah. he knows he's going...
Guaranteed paycheck.
He'll take yeah. care of the family. He'll yeah. ride his 2010 Toyota Corolla into the ground. where I'm is like, okay, Range Rover, Porsche. Like, it's balance.
It.
You need balance in a relationship,
yes,
right?
Yeah, it's true. So true.
Yes. So he was very supportive, but like colleagues thought I was crazy. Kids cried. I cried because that's all I knew.
Yeah. How long were you a teacher before?
3 years.
It was 3 years. So you had a connection to your coworkers, yeah. to everybody.
Yeah. Yes. Kids. And they're like, you're crazy. You're going to go leave for, you know, something that you don't know where it's going to be in 5 years. And I'm like, I'm going to try it.
Yeah.
And I did.
Yeah. So, good for you.
Thank you.
Easy to say while you're staying a teacher.
Yeah, easy to, well.
Nothing against teachers.
Nothing against, I just don't think people realize the opportunities that are out there.
Yeah.
Because so many people come to me all the time, they're like, I want to be a realtor. And I'm like, well, guess what? We all can't be realtors.
Right.
We all can't do marketing. We all can't be police officers. Like, yeah. you find what you're good at and you stick to it.
Yeah. Are you familiar with any of the, I just learned about them like a couple months ago, but like these apps and platforms for like just consumers to get into real estate investing? Like, there's one called Fundrise. There's one called CrowdStreet. I don't know. Have you ever heard of these?
No,
so,
I haven't.
Yeah, they're like these. They're basically like consumer friendly. Like, think of like Robinhood or like.
Okay.
A friendly like stock platform, yep. but like for real estate.
Okay. No, I haven't. But the majority of people who I meet that might be looking for their first home, single yeah. family, I like to give them the runaround of, hey, have you thought about your first purchase being an investment property
yeah,
instead
yeah.
of being a single family? And right. one of my biggest regrets at the now looking back was that my first property was not an investment property.
I was going to ask you that too.
It was a condo, but at the time I was like, I want that house. I want like my own
yeah.
being. I don't want to be a landlord. Like, who wants to take care of tenants and toilets right, and, right. you know, collect rent. Yeah. But when you are a first time home buyer and you're going to put money down into a house, you could put as little as 0% down,
right.
which is incredible.
Yeah.
Versus when you buy that single family and let's say put 0 to 20% down wherever you fall. When you go to buy your investment property after you've already purchased one, it's 25% down. Versus if you bought a multifamily, you lived in it for 6 months, then put a tenant in there,
yeah.
you could go again and you could buy another multifamily for 3 to 5% down.
Really?
Live in it for 6 months. Renovate it, put a tenant in, and keep doing it. And that's how people build so much wealth. Like, anybody who was starting to do this now at 18, 19 years old could easily surpass me at 27 yeah. by doing that instead of the way I did it.
Is that the minimum 6 months you have to live in there? Because I know there's like a requirement, right?
Yes, it's yeah. 6 months. Okay. But it's so smart. And people are like, why yeah. do not more people do this?
Right,
because
right.
they don't know. They're right. not aware yeah. of how you can build wealth in real estate.
Yeah. And do you think there's a lot in it that's like fear of like,
yes,
like similar to your coworkers, like the unknown or like the risk?
Yes.
Life is all about risks.
It's all about, you're not going to get like ahead what? If you don't take a risk.
Yeah. Yes. Like, I can't imagine just settling
yes.
and just being like, I don't know, so complacent, I guess.
Yes.
Right.
And I'm the exact opposite believer in that. And I even see it in a lot of my clients. Analysis paralysis is what a term I learned on Bigger Pockets. And that means that...
Oh, that's one of the podcasts I was
yeah,
listening to.
I love Bigger Pockets.
Yeah, it's a good one.
I listened to them for like months before we were ready to pull the trigger.
That's cool.
And you get so obsessed with analyzing deals, does this work, that you just never actually jump in.
Right.
And your first property, investment property, is not going to be a home run.
Right.
It, you're just getting your feet wet.
Exactly.
And until people realize that, like, years have gone by and you've just missed out on so many opportunities.
Yeah, like you could think about it and look at, oh, should I do this? Should I do this? Excuse me. And then, yeah, like you said, all of a sudden it's been like 2 years. And if you had done it,
yeah.
you would have made like, you know, a shit ton of money or something. And but now you just wasted 2 years just thinking about it.
Yes.
It's like decision fatigue in a sense.
Correct. So our first property that we bought, it was like, it will be 2 years actually in July. We were so nervous, first investment property, and we bought it for $212
yeah.
in the lovely town of Springfield, Massachusetts. Are you familiar with that?
I am.
Okay, yep. Great
town. Way out west, right? That's the one past Worcester.
Yes.
Yeah, I got you.
And we were scared shitless, to be quite frank with you. And
yeah.
We don't make a ton of money month to month, but we could turn around and resell that two family today for $350,000. And we bought it at $212
How much did you put work into it?
We renovated one whole unit but it's been the same tenants since. So we've had the same tenants for 2 years. But we also learned that you don't necessarily need to renovate. Like people will live as it is and
right.
you fix and make updates as needed instead of going to pour money out of your pocket to do this.
Interesting.
And appreciation will do its thing in the correct markets.
I guess I've always thought like you need to do renovations. Or not, I mean, not necessarily, but like I've always felt like most times like you
yeah.
need to, but it's interesting to hear kind of the opposite. Like
yeah.
people,
you don't need to
just like make it livable,
yeah. and a little bit above livable. So you're not a slumlord.
Sure.
But speaking of making updates, my husband and I did our first flip right before our wedding last year. And this was before we were savvy like we are now, and we used yeah. all of our own money.
Really?
And it was right before our wedding, as you know, is a very big financial
yeah.
thing that you do. And all of our money was tied up. And we're both realtors, and we sell a lot of properties, and everybody else's properties would sell like this.
Right.
Over asking, like 10, 15, 20,000 over asking.
Yeah.
We go to list our flip, and nobody wants it. And it's beautiful, but it was small. It was 2-bed, 1-bath. It was a condo, like
yeah.
only 800 square feet, and there were no buyers for it. And I just remember like sitting at dinner, we would look at each other and we wouldn't even talk because all of our money was tied up, and we're like, we can't even afford this dinner right now until this thing closes, and we're getting married in a month. Like, this is terrible. Yeah. But we ended up winning from that and buying two more properties from it. So if you don't take the risk, there's no reward.
That's so crazy. And what a time to do it, by the way.
Right.
What a time. It was horrible.
Leading up to your wedding.
Talk about taking chances.
Yeah. The appraisal was literally like the week before we were going away to New Hampshire. And I'm like, sir, I'm getting married next week. Like, we have to make this work here. Don't come in low, please.
Getting started in, like, talk a little bit about getting to the point where you thought about doing a flip. Like, you did investment property one or two before that?
Yes. We did a few investment properties. We now own seven. But this flip, so I'm kind of a wheeler dealer. And in the neighborhood that we were living in, I got wind that somebody was renting it. And I got wind that he wanted to sell it. So I went to marched right over there. And I was like, two options for you. One, I can sell this for top dollar for you on the market as your realtor. Two, I can just take this off of your hands for a very low cash deal. Which never in a million years did I think he would take the low option, but you never know people's circumstances and how quickly they need to move.
Or why they're selling. Yeah, exactly.
Exactly. He didn't even live around here. He was from New York. He held this for a long time and he was like, Brooke, I just want to take this off my hands. Yeah. I'm like, perfect. Sign here. Like, don't change your mind. We're going into contract. So we ended up getting it for a crazy price that made the flip work. And we've only done one, but now if I were to ever do another flip again, I would not touch my own money. Now I'm learning about hard money, and other people will lend you money to do renovations. So like, their money's on the line, not yours. You can still live.
Right.
And at the end, maybe you just won't make as great of a profit because you need to pay them back.
Sure.
But it's not going to totally affect your day-to-day routine. You can still get your Starbucks.
Yeah.
And you're not stressing out a week before your wedding.
Exactly. Right. No more weddings.
Yeah. That's funny. One of my questions was about the flip. Like, talk a little bit about that process of like the construction and the timeline and it being your first one. Like, was there a lot of learning, I'm sure, as you were going? Like,
so much learning. Something that we thought was going to take like 2 months in and out ended up being 6 months. Something that we thought was going to cost $20,000 cost $50,000.
Yeah.
And we did, not we, my husband and his dad did a lot of the work himself, and I was just there cheering him on or being like, hurry up. but nothing ever goes as planned, ever. Yeah. And you have to always over budget and over do your timeline because it's never going to be as easy as you think.
Now, was this during like the COVID times where the lead times were crazy no matter what?
Yes. So I remember we ordered windows like the day we closed on the house, and the windows, it took 6 months for the windows to come in.
Oh my God. Yes.
That's wild.
And we're like, what the heck?
That's wild.
But it was a good return and
worth it. So
we 1031'd. Do you guys know about 1031ing?
I've heard it.
You've heard
it. But I don't know.
Okay. So 1031 is a way that you can save your money from paying taxes.
Okay.
So, okay, we made, let's say, $40,000 on our flip. When we closed on that, we didn't see that $40,000. Because if we did, then we'd be taxed on it and we would owe like 20%, 25% back to the government. So what you do with 1031 is you take that, your massive win and the money from the property, and then you go buy more properties.
Uh-huh.
So it's putting off your capital gains.
Rolling it over into the next property.
Correct.
Got you.
We've learned that. Yeah, we work with we do a lot of video stuff for a real estate developer.
Okay.
Up in the North Shore, and they build a lot of like larger, like, 100, 200 unit apartment buildings.
Does he need a realtor?
Maybe, I'll ask them. They just do the development, and then they usually hire out like a property manager or like a whatever, all the other aspects to it. But but like through doing a lot of work with them, we've learned like a good amount of stuff about real estate. Mm-hmm. And
he's talked about
that. I just don't remember it being referred to as 1031. But we learned about that concept of like basically deferring like the money.
Putting it off and off and off.
Yeah.
At one day, somebody's going to need to pay it.
Right.
So
we also had a quick crash course in, was it the Opportunity Zones?
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And how you can like build an opportunity zone and you hold it for 10 years and they don't have to pay any taxes on it when you sell it.
Yeah. Yeah, that, and you get a discount on the taxes as you go. Yeah,
something
yeah.
like that. He did a whole video on it. It was very interesting.
It is. And I mean, location like matters. If you get into a place like that right now, that there's not much going on and it starts to grow and expand, like you're going to 10X your money.
10X. That's funny. One question I had, like, so for people who are thinking of getting into real estate, like, because obviously most people, I guess, like you did, got into it more on the side, like you were a teacher at the time.
Yeah.
A lot of people start to get into it on the side or think about it. Yeah. Talk a little bit about, like, the time commitment of getting started in the beginning and, like how much time were you really spending in the beginning on the side, you know, outside of your normal job?
Okay. So most people typically do real estate as a part-time job to start. And I tell people, like, people graduate and say, Brooke, I want to be a full-time agent. And I'm like, well, get a part-time job because you're not going to make a dollar until something closes. And you could be working with clients for months before something closes or never even close with them. So, it all depends. Like, I recommend getting maybe like a bartending job or something. So you're still in front of people and you're advertising for yourself when you're there, but you still have some sort of stream of income coming in. But to get into it, it's all that you make it, I guess. You either sink or swim. It's a very oversaturated market and there are so many agents out there. Ever since Selling Sunset came out.
Did you guys
show. He talks about that.
Who's your favorite?
Probably, I actually met the two brothers.
You did?
Jason and, what
Brett.
Yes, Brett. Yeah. I met them. I have family in Los Angeles. So I go out there from time to time. And I was out there. My wife and I went for like a long weekend.
Yep.
And there's a coffee shop chain out there called Alfred. It's very popular. There's one on Melrose Place, which is like basically the west side of West Hollywood. It's like right below Beverly Hills.
Okay.
All like actors, actresses, like high-end people frequent this area because it's all the high-end designer stores, like Louis Vuitton and everything is over there.
Yeah.
And Alfred's just like a famous coffee spot. Anyway, long story, but we're standing in line and we order our coffee and we're waiting outside. And who do we see standing in line at the back? Our two short, like... almost bald
short
guys.
Billionaires.
Yeah, 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 exactly. And I was like sitting there, and then I think my wife saw, like, Monica looked at me and she's like, "Hey, look at the back of the line." And I was like, "Oh my god!" I was like, "Holy shit!" I was like, "That's the two. That's Selling Sunset." I was like, "Those are the Oppenheim brothers."
Yeah.
And I was like, "Oh my god, I want to say hi to them." And she's like, "Oh, but you know, you don't want to bother him." I was like, "No, I know." I was like, "Fuck it." So like they were waiting for that coffee and I did it very, like, casually. I just walked by, and I went to, like, grab my coffee, and I came back, and I just, like, stopped, and I was like, "Hey, guys, like, I just want to say I'm a huge fan. I watched the show. Like, you guys are awesome." And they're like, "Oh, thanks, man." And anyway, it was pretty, it was wild. It was like seeing, like, a celebrity. Which
how, with that show, how much of it is faked, do you think, and how much is it reality?
I think a lot of the drama is... all elevated, be honest. But I mean, the real estate portion itself is so cool. And I think that's why after that came out and then they did like Selling Tampa or like multiple different spins off of it. Yeah. And then you see all of everybody like, "Oh, I like this.
So
I want to get
many
into this."
I feel like it just created this boom of people who are just like, I'm going to get my real estate license.
And I'll just start making money right away.
Yeah.
Which is the furthest thing from the truth.
right.
Furthest thing from the truth. But like for the people who are starting out, I recommend you need a good mentor and you need somebody to teach you the reins and you're going to learn from them and make your own spinoff. But it's a hard world out there and you're helping people buy their biggest asset and getting started with no experience is, you know, that's why they say the majority of the agents within the first year quit.
Really?
Yes, because they're not seeing instant success.
Wow.
But if you stick with it, it can be a nice gig.
Yeah, yeah. One of my best friends, his fiance is an agent. I don't know if it's close to you. It's they live in next to Gardner.
Okay.
Do you know Baldwinsville?
It's basically New Hampshire. It's
like
really
Templeton, Baldwinsville.
I've heard of these areas. It's not too close.
Anyway, she's an agent and she is like you, super people person, like go-getter, really like out there. And she's been doing it for like I want to say 3 or 4 years, maybe 3 years. And she's doing great. Like, yeah. She's killing it. Yeah. And it was funny, like her fiance, my friend, I remember when she first started, he was like, yeah, Ivana's going to like get into real estate. I was like, oh, that's really cool. Like, good for her.
Yeah.
And then like a year later, I remember seeing him and I was like, oh, how's Ivana doing with real estate? He's like, dude, she's fucking crushing it. He's like, she just bought herself a new car.
Yeah.
Like, she's killing it. Yes. I was like, hell yeah, that's sick. And yeah. Like, she's still doing
good
awesome.
For her. And yeah. Don't get me wrong. So many people succeed.
Right.
But a lot of them don't.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
To your point too, I think it does take a certain personality. Like, you even walked into the office and you know you're happy. You're
yeah.
I think you need to have that like outgoing personality in order to do it.
I agree. And I also think it is a confidence thing
yeah,
too. Like 100%. You need to know what you're talking about and believe that you know what you're talking yeah. about. I mentor a few agents too. And they're like, Brooke, my thing is confidence. I'm like, well, I can't teach you that.
Right.
You have to right. believe in what you're saying, whether it's you're going to order a coffee or you're trying to sell a house.
Like, yeah. Yeah.
You either have it or you don't have it, or you can work on it to get it.
Right.
But that does separate a lot of agents from each other, I would say.
Because people like, it's like almost like people just follow you if you're confident in a sense. Not like follow you in like what you do, but like if you're confident in the decisions you're making or like what you're saying and what you're doing, like,
yes,
it's just people will follow you. Whereas like if you're unsure, then they're unsure.
Then the house is going to be sold by somebody else.
Right, they're not right. getting the deal. Yeah. Like I think of it like into photography in a sense. A couple weeks ago, I was helping one of my friends. He was training a new photographer. And so he asked me and my wife to be like models for a photo shoot to help train awesome. This photographer. And her thing was confidence, which is like, that's how everybody starts. Like, I wasn't confident as a photographer at first, like
yeah.
directing people and being like, oh, okay, like, Brendan, move your arm here, put it on Brooke's shoulder, or like put this here, or like whatever, like move your body this way.
Yep.
Like directing people is like similar in a sense, like of the confidence. Like you need to have that. Otherwise, people are going to be like feel awkward when you're photographing them and like.
It translates.
Yeah, yes. Exactly.
Yes.
So yeah, like having that confidence is for sure. Like yep. That's a big thing.
I agree.
I got a self-serving question for us.
Okay.
How important is like photo and video now in the real estate world?
It is yeah. so important. Marketing nowadays, it's what sells these houses. And I think it makes a massive difference in who people choose to go with as realtors when selling their house. Like there are a lot of older agents that maybe social media is not their thing.
Right.
And it's like, well, you're missing a major audience of potential buyers for your house.
Right.
So your videos, your pictures, and agents spend a lot of money on that, but the audience is there.
Yeah.
The millennials, I feel like an old person saying. But like the younger generations, like they're the ones who are buying that. Right now. Yes. Right. Nobody's looking in the newspaper anymore. Even just like Facebook.
Right.
Facebook's not the hottest thing anymore. It's Instagram. It's TikTok. Right. It's the new generation yeah. of people where they're at.
And I see like you put a lot of time into your videos, like making them actually great and like personable and showing your face. Like in the beginning, like I see you intro the house and then yes. they should pull in. The video pulls in and you see the house. It's pretty good.
Usually. Well, even like looking at like the Zillow listings, like we were talking, if you go in and I've looked at houses in there before and like they'll have like stuff that doesn't make sense. Everything's yes. cluttered. It looks like crap.
Yes.
I'm clicking off that in a second.
Exactly.
I'm not going to go through there.
Nobody. Yeah. Yes.
And that's Zillow. That's not even looking at an Instagram post or anything.
Yes. Some people say, oh, I'll just take pictures. I'll take it on my cell phone. And right. guess you just lost out on a ton of money. You did not maximize your asset here. I'm working with this one client. She's a very sweet woman and she's a single mother and she's getting her house ready to go on the market. And I said, do you need a little extra push? Do you need some help? And she did. So I was like, if you don't mind, give me the key when you're at work. I'll go into your house. I will get it all ready for you as long yeah. as you don't mind me touching your stuff
yeah.
for the pictures and the videos. Because if we were to photograph
yeah.
it as is, like you're not going to maximize
yeah,
your profit here.
Yeah.
So yes, pictures and videos are extremely important.
And if you sell the house, it just we're out of the commission, right?
Oh, yeah.
It just pays yes. for itself. Well, not pays for itself, but
worthwhile.
A good expense.
And it's a
good
write-off.
Expense. And right. it's a write-off.
And
yeah, there you go.
It goes to your brand. So I hope yeah. other, you know, clients out there are looking at my stuff saying, wow, look at Brooke's marketing.
Right.
I take my marketing stuff to other listing appointments and I say, like, look what I could do for your house here. Watch yeah. this video. Look at these pictures.
Your
like,
portfolio for yourself.
Portfolio. Yes.
That's perfect.
Do you still find, I guess you were kind of just saying, but do you still find agents that you know of or, you know, hear of or whatever that just think that they can just take their own photos?
Sometimes. Yeah. Like they'll say it, maybe if it's under a certain price point, they do it because obviously the higher the price point, the more commission you're going to make. But my argument to that is if you're going out there saying you offer top-notch service from top to bottom, pictures reflect that. So if my pictures for my $200,000 listing are going to look as good as my $3.5 million listing, it doesn't matter. It's you as a brand, you as a face.
Yeah. That's important. That's actually a really good point. I went to an event one time that had a lot of real estate agents. This was like a couple months back. I was really trying to get into real estate work. And I met with some agents and that's exactly what they said. Like in just like casual conversations, they were like, yeah, like I'll only do like good photos for certain listings. And like, I was like, oh, okay. Not really thinking of it because I know nothing about the real estate market.
Yep.
But yeah, hearing that, like if you're going to take crappy photos at a lower listing, like how do you say you offer great service, but you don't really give a shit about your $200,000 listing, but you will about a $600,000. Like what?
Yeah. And at the end of like your clients matter,
right?
No matter what their price point, what their budgets are. And it just leads to more clients. Mm-hmm. I think of it as an investment each time I make those gross payments, but
but on the same hand, what about the marketing of the brokerage?
I think marketing of the brokerage is extremely important,
like too. Getting to know the real estate agent or knowing who works there and stuff like that.
And our brokerage itself, we are up and coming. We have over 20 agents now since we signed last February.
Yeah,
but we're young, we're hungry, and mm-hmm. it's different than maybe some of these other brokerages where people are a tad bit older. Like we're up and coming.
Yeah. You're young groups here, hustlers.
Sounds like you guys need your own Selling Massachusetts.
Yeah.
Can you say that again so I can... I'm going to make sure Mike Burns watches this.
And we'll produce it.
Okay, yes. There we go. Yeah. There we go. It's a win-win for everybody. Yeah,
exactly.
We can make up the drama and...
storylines.
Are you writing the scenes? Or
We can do that.
Some, right? Yeah.
I'm sure everybody will be on board.
Just create stuff like...
Did you hear Brooke said that?
Yeah, I was talking to somebody too about Selling Sunset, and they were saying the same thing. Like, oh, the drama's like so exaggerated. Like, it has to be.
Yes.
You watch that shit, and like, oh my god.
It has to be. But let me tell you, like, it's a competitive world out there in the real estate field. Like, everybody's gonna be nice to everybody's faces, different agents. But it's like, did you see she got that list, or did you see what she sold it for? I went for that listing. I didn't get that. So, as much as we're all friends, like my best friend was her admin, and now she got her real estate license.
Yeah,
one of the smartest people I know, and of course, we all root for each other. Mm. But it's competitive.
Yeah,
it's a very competitive field.
Yeah, yeah.
So yes, there is definitely drama that's maybe not made up, but Selling Sunset. That level is definitely extra.
They need it for the cameras.
Yes.
Yeah.
For the views.
There's the new one I really like is Buying Beverly Hills. Did you see that one?
Yes, it's newer. Watched that one too.
I thought it was pretty good. But there's again like all the drama about like the family, because the dad is the CEO of the company.
Yes.
And he gives some great listings to his daughter. So then some of the other agents are like, oh, did you see like she got the listing because she's his daughter, and like she's not even experienced.
Yeah, yes, and they just like,
and they just like complain and shit.
Yep.
But they just got renewed for a second season, which I'm pretty excited about.
When's
it
coming out? Do you know?
No, I don't.
Okay, but Selling Hopefully Sunset soon. Comes out the 19th. So
another
mark
one.
Mark your calendars.
Jesus, like season 7.
Yes.
Oh my god, that's a good one. But the husband Mauricio is his name. He wrote a book actually. And I bought it, so I'm pretty excited to read it.
Let me know if
it's worth it. I'll let you know if it's worth it. I'll send it to you after I read it.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Being such a busy person and like doing so much, you guys invest, you have Airbnb properties, like how do you find time to like relax and like not work? Like where's the off button? When does that happen?
Is there an off button?
Honestly, right now, no.
Really?
I'm up at 4:30 in the morning and I go to bed like 9:30, 10. But when you're not working right now, like you're not making money. And sometimes I do struggle. It's a struggle, but I like it. I'm like sick like that. Like I'm like, I start working before I even go to the bathroom in the morning. Like I roll over, get my phone and start checking my text message emails. Like people are like, Brooke, you sent an email at 5:01. I'm like, I wish it was before 4. But that's how you get ahead. And that's how I think that separates so many people. I'm not picking and choosing when I'm working. But at the end, it's a lot. It's a lot on your body. It's a lot on your mind. And like, I'm going away for 4 days for my anniversary. I'm like, it's going to be okay. I need a life too.
Yeah.
But it's nice that my husband does this with me. So he understands. We take our dog for a walk every day. Like maybe that's my off time when I go for a walk. But I enjoy it. I'm weird. Yeah. I'm sick.
Addicted to it.
I'm addicted. I am addicted to it. Some people are addicted to gambling or coffee or whatever. I'm addicted to business and making money.
That's not a bad thing to be addicted
better
to.
Than being addicted to better than drugs or stealing money from people off the streets in Providence, like you were saying. Addicted to the game, okay?
I wish I had that recording when you told that story.
Me too.
I'll have to tell it after. We'll put the clip together.
Yeah.
Yes.
Random question. Do you go to the casino ever? Do you like gambling? Yes?
I've been there a few times. I'm not very good at it. Okay. It's fun, but
you make your money working.
Yeah. Oh, I'll tell this one little story. So Mike, who I've mentioned 100 times in here, he likes to gamble. That's okay. He has a lot of money. And he was on a win streak last football season. And I was like, you know what, Mike? Tell me who you're putting your money on. I'm going to put my money on the same people you are. Well, he went 0-6. And I ended up losing, like, it was $1,200. And that was before, like, real estate became very big. That's a lot of money.
Yeah.
So I started selling things off Facebook Marketplace and to try to make back that $1,200. Yeah. And I'm like, never again am I gambling on anything.
Yeah. Oh, that's funny.
The house always wins no matter what.
Yes, I'm like, not going to win. I learned my lesson.
That's funny.
What's the saying? They always keep the lights are always on in Vegas.
They're never gonna lose.
Exactly. I every time I like to gamble every once in a while, but I promise I do not have a problem. Now
you're reassuring yourself of that?
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Mike and I have a problem.
So Monica and I will go to like either Foxwoods or Mohegan like once in a blue moon.
Yeah.
And when I do great, I'm psyched. Like back in September, my best win ever, I went after a wedding. I shot a wedding in Providence, finished at like 9:30, 10 o'clock, drove down, met two of my cousin-in-laws down at Foxwoods for the night.
Yep.
And I didn't get down there till like 10:30, 11, and we stayed up late. But I got down there, it was kind of on a whim, and I took $200 and I turned it into like $1,300.
Wow.
And I was psyched. I played roulette for like 2 hours or so, and
red
I just
or black.
I play numbers and color, so usually I'll play black, but
yeah, I always go black. As well. Okay. Yeah.
But I was playing numbers and I was hitting a lot, and I was crushing it. So anyway, made $1,300. I was psyched, and then every time I go after that every time I don't win, all I think about is like, you know what? There's no shortcuts to success, Mike. You gotta work for your money. Work is the only way to truly like make your money.
Yeah,
it's like so funny.
But. Yeah, but I mean, you hear stories like that. Even in I live in Belchertown. If any of you've heard of that before,
far out there.
West.
Yeah,
and somebody won like $multi-million at the Stop and Shop I go to every day off of a scratch ticket.
Oh my
and
God!
And I'm like, what the heck?
Yeah,
and we'll probably never know who it was. They'll probably keep it anonymous, but.
Right. So. We also hear the stories of people doing that and they're broke in a year.
Yeah.
It's like, how the hell did you do that?
Yes, because people can't manage their money.
They say that off the interest. Yes. That's all you got to do.
Yes.
I don't. Yeah. See, like you see so many stories. Like I hear that most people who win the lottery like end up broke. or like depressed or like dead within like a couple of years just because like it ruined their life. I mean, I can't, like obviously I've never hit the lottery or anything, but like I don't. Like how? Why, how can't you just
do something with smart? Fast life.
I guess. Yeah. There was a guy. Like the only story that I've read so far, back in like February, I think it was. There was the $2 billion, like Mega Millions or Powerball.
Yep.
Some guy from Southern California won, and there was like 3 articles within like 2 months. That dude was blowing cash. Like it was his job.
Yeah.
Like at that point, it probably was. But he got the $2 billion. First of all, out of a $2 billion jackpot, guess how much he made?
How much?
Guess how much like you actually he ended up?
I have no idea.
$997 million. He lost a whole billion in taxes and like.
Yeah.
And like,
not surprised about that, especially California.
Yeah.
Too. They take
I guess that's true. It probably does depend on the state you receive it.
But you know what he should have done? Bought real estate.
There you go.
He did. So he took, so anyway, so he ended up with like $997 million, I think the article said. a month after he won, he bought a $25 million mansion in Beverly Hills.
Okay, but that's silly.
Okay, invest in like some like normal properties, yeah. Dude.
And that lucky agent.
Yeah, right. The commission on that.
What's the commission on $25 million? Jesus Christ,
That's going to be pretty high.
Yeah. Anyway, and then like a month later, another article came out that he bought like a $4 or $5 million house somewhere else in California. But who knows? Maybe he died.
I hope not.
maybe he's addicted to drugs. Yeah. And ruined his life.
Exactly.
I don't know.
Yes. But, money can lead to bad things.
Yeah.
I got a question.
Go for it.
It's kind of random.
That's okay.
But we've always talked about it because like being in the city, we were talking about the parking lot outside.
Yeah.
Is a parking lot a good investment? And like, if you were to buy, like, if you were in Providence, yes. Like, I always look for parking lots in Providence that we could buy and rent out the spots because I feel like that's an easy to maintain, like, straightforward.
Yeah, and you're not dealing with tenants. I think that could be fantastic if it's in a good location where people are going to utilize that. That's funny that you say that. When I was growing up and we'd go to like the beach or something like Watch Hill, I love that spot in Rhode Island.
Yeah,
I'm like, they're charging $40 a car here.
Exactly.
Who owns this parking lot? Every single day they're packed. So I do think depending on location, parking lots are a good investment.
Yeah, because we had our first office was a couple blocks over, and I think it was $220 a month to pay for one car. One car.
Yeah.
And then again, they're always booked.
To what? To maintain, to shovel, to take care of cracks that happen.
Yeah.
You don't have a lot of expenses.
It wasn't even paved. Like, it was like all old.
Yeah, it was gravel?
Well, it wasn't gravel. It was just very, very old. Like, it needed
so it had a lot of cracks.
Okay. Bad, yeah.
Bad shape.
So they're not taking care of it, which is fine, but people are still parking there. Yeah.
It's parkable.
Yeah. I just didn't know if there was like, because it just seems so simple. I don't know if there was like a downside to it that I wasn't thinking of.
Nobody sells it. There's not a market for it because when people have it, they don't sell it.
They're going to keep it.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's true. There's a couple around here, but some of them need a lot of work.
Yeah.
Just like dirt patches, basically.
Yeah. But I mean, it's a lot less of an investment than buying a three family, four family.
Right.
True,
right.
Yeah.
What being, how many properties do you own that you, how many properties do you own that like people live in?
Six.
What is that like being a landlord? Or do you have somebody that's like a manager?
No, we do it all ourselves.
You do? What is that like?
It's not bad. So far, knock on wood, we have decent tenants.
Yeah.
I think that tenant clientele is the biggest part. Like, you want good tenants and you want your tenants to like you to a degree and you want to like them.
Right.
But at the end of the day, you have to remember like people are human, but you need to get paid and... If you're getting paid and the building is still standing, it's a win. That's what I think. But like people get into this business and they think on the first of every month, I'm getting my rent from all of my tenants. That is the biggest farce you'll ever hear. I mean, by the 15th, that's like my cutoff. And then
that's pretty generous too.
That seems generous.
But I say it's due on the first by the 5th.
Yeah.
And then if I don't have it by the 5th, the 15th is the cutoff or we're going to serve you.
Yeah. Yeah.
And as long as nobody takes too bad of advantage.
Right.
And knock on wood again, they don't call us that often. I mean, very rarely, except on Christmas Eve this year, we were deflooding a basement. And I was like, why are we doing this? We should have just stayed teaching. Christmas Eve, yeah, Santa's coming, not. But where are we going with that? It's
landlord, yeah.
It's not bad, but not everybody's cut out to be a landlord, and that is for sure.
Do you ever get the call like 2-3 in the morning?
No.
You never had any of
those? I've never gotten like late night calls. So far it's been okay.
You're probably up answering emails anyways, so.
Yeah. No, no, I would not answer my tenants. No, but it's like something people don't necessarily do, and I'm included in this and I need to do better at, is raising people's rents. So like we bought a house at whatever we bought it at, we raised their tenants' rents to X, like we're winning.
Yeah.
And I always thought, okay, well, until the tenant moves out, like we'll let them ride out that rent. But it's a business. So like every year you should increase your tenants' rents.
Costs go up.
And then when you go to resell, at least your rents will be closer to market value than if you left them at what they were when you purchased.
Right.
So there's a lot that goes into it.
Yeah.
But good tenants are key.
Yeah.
Yeah. I would say the hardest ones are the ones that you inherit. Because you don't know much about them and they're already there. So the only issue tenants we've had would be the ones that we already purchased and they were already in there.
They're already living there.
Yes.
Because you can't, is there like a law you can't kick them out?
If they're in a lease, you can't kick them out. And right. At the end of the day, you have no idea who these people are.
Right.
And they don't know you. And it's like, we're not coming in here to kick you out. We're coming in here to raise your rent. And yeah. We want you to stay. We don't want issues. That's the last right. thing anybody wants. You just get a pay and live your life and we'll stay right. away from you.
Yeah, yeah.
But then the Airbnb side.
Yeah.
What are some?
Let's get into it.
Yeah. I love Airbnb.
Really?
Yes.
We've had our beefs, but okay.
Okay. Have you stayed in one since?
VRBO only.
Okay.
I made it a point. Grudge. Actually, I got back from Florida like 2 weeks ago, and I used VRBO to book the thing down there.
Yep. I've stayed in Airbnbs.
We used Airbnb to rent locations for like commercial shoots and stuff.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
So we still use them.
And we used Airbnb for Florida last year, Orlando for the wedding.
You sure? Was Airbnb. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Okay, so
usually
maybe
good experiences. Yeah. Just the you know, like the cliche things you hear, like the odd cleaning requests, like, oh, put the dishes back and put this here and
yes.
Take all the sheets off and roll them up in a ball and throw them in this closet.
Yes. Like
just random things.
Random, yeah, I do all those random
things. Do you?
But I feel like you need to have the process.
Sometimes it does something. Right?
Yes, like, but the amount of people who don't do it, it's fine. It's just to get a head start. And it depends on guests. Like sometimes it was just a couple's weekend away, which and the house is like untouched.
Right.
But then sometimes these bachelor parties where the house is trashed and you only have that window of time. Like let's say your checkout's at 10 and guests are coming at 2. You only have that window of time, so those odd requests are just to get the ball rolling
we've never had any problems.
Do you use your cleaning crew to clean your Airbnbs? Oh, perfect.
So I like to show people, I like to tell the story. Like I buy the building, so I eat there. I manage the building with a team of 4 other people, and then my cleaners clean. So within 3 ecosystems, we're taking care of this Airbnb, which is fantastic. And we own the Airbnb with a team of 4. It's me, my husband, and then our other business partners, Cody and Lauren, who are fantastic. And we each have our own roles.
Nice.
Like Cody and Lauren, Cody handles the app itself. So he automates all these messages. Like, I don't even know if people are staying there right now or not. They'll get all these texts. And if there are any issues, like owing people money, Cody takes care of it. Mm. Lauren takes care of the marketing, the whole 9 yards. Since I'm on my phone all the time, I take care of the guest texting and my cleaners, and then my husband's the handyman, and there's never really that many handyman projects he has to do, so he's hands off.
That's cool though. Yeah, you set up a
Brendan,
whole
the dresser needs to be fixed.
Yeah, but Brendan, the glass is broken in the fireplace, you need to take care of that.
But it's repeatable and you can just keep going and going.
Like, yeah,
how many properties do you have now?
In total
for Airbnb 7.
So we own 1. And then I went to this beautiful house on the water in Sturbridge, Mass. For a cleaning quote. And she lives in this beautiful on-the-lake lakefront property 1 week out of the year and lives in California all the other times.
That's
and I'm
insane.
Like, you want to sell this? And she's like, no. And then she was like, would you be interested in managing our Airbnb? And I'm like, I'm not going to say no. We already do our own, but I've never handled anybody else's property. And then we talked, and we manage her property for 30% of all profits, where there were 0 upfront investment from us.
That's pretty cool.
So it's not, and that is booked like all of the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I saw the 2. So, okay. So 1 you guys bought, and then another 1 is something
we just manage.
You manage.
Yeah.
I think I saw both of them. Both beautiful houses. One of them was like on a lake?
Yes, that's the one that we manage.
Oh, okay.
That house we could probably sell for like $1 million.
Yeah, it's so nice.
Gorgeous. But to think somebody's literally living there 1 year.
1 week.
1 week out of the year.
That's insane.
I'm like, who are you people?
Yeah, right?
What do you do?
Right.
But then we bought a smaller, it's a 3-bed, 1 bath across the street from a lake. And that one's doing very well. We put a hot tub in there, so people love the hot tub amenity, and it works.
That's cool, the one on the lake, because eventually that person's going to want to sell, and you're going to be first in line
for
it.
Hey, we took such good care of you. But she's happy, too, because it was just sitting there.
Right.
So for years, I mean, she has a tenant upstairs, but for years that whole property would sit there making no money. So to her, she loves us because she just gets a direct deposit each month. Hey, we had this many guests stay.
She's just getting free money in a sense. That's cool. Because you guys now, since you're managing, are you taking care of any like repairs too?
Yes.
Hmm.
Yes.
Cool. Yeah.
Wow. We still have to take care of that glass and the fireplace. Brendan.
Oh, that's a real story.
It's a real story. Yeah.
What, I guess, like, do you have any funny stories from Airbnb?
Yes. So it was actually just.
Give us one good one.
I'm trying to think. Well, it might not be too funny to you guys, but just laugh anyway. So yeah. we just had a recent guest, and he was messaging me kind of like nonsense before he even got there. So I already had a weird feeling about him being there.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden it was like later at night, 9 o'clock, and he's messaging me and he's like, Fox bit me, ER, blood, fireplace. Like, I think he didn't speak great English, but none of this was making sense. So we're like, are you okay? Like, is the house okay? Like, what can we do to help you? And he's like, I am an ER. I was trying to get firewood for the fire. Mind you, in big letters, it says, do not use fireplace in the house. We're like, what do you mean you're using the fireplace? Like, you're not supposed to use the fireplace. And a fox attacked me when he was getting the firewood, and he's bleeding throughout the house. And we're like, what the heck? What? And then Cody and Lauren, being like the very logical ones in the group, they like Googled the guy's name, and he was imprisoned like last year for embezzlement or something. So I'm like, first of all, he probably didn't even get bit by this fox, and now he's going to try to sue us because we didn't take care. So it was just a crazy story, and we ended up charging him $250 extra for the glass that's broken on the fireplace. But we have no idea if he was actually attacked by a fox or not. Or
you never heard from him again?
No.
What?
But like, I'm going to say that he wasn't if you haven't heard from him.
No, but you don't know the people who are staying at your place. Like, you have no idea. And it could be scary. I mean, they have all these insurance policies. God forbid things happen. Yeah. But I mean, like, that guy could have tried to take, and it's not even our house, but that guy could have tried to sue us to say he got bit with rabies or something.
Yeah.
Jesus.
That's wild.
Yeah.
That's insane.
That's my craziest story.
That's, that is pretty wild. Yeah,
exactly.
And then I'm curious, like, what, On the backside of things, like, does Airbnb take a lot of money from the hosts?
Cody takes care of, like, the number-wise. It's not that much of a percent, but you would never get the viewings and everything without it. So it's needed.
It's the platform.
Yeah.
It's where and everybody's looking.
You can mark up to make whatever you need, and like every day is different. So like Monday to Thursday are different fees than your Friday to Thursday
like a
to Sunday.
Or like
holidays
that.
Are more expensive. Yeah. And the cleaning fees are not included, I'm sure, as you guys know, in that stay. So that's just an additional fee that needs to be paid.
Yeah.
I'm just going right back into your pocket anyways.
Right back into my pocket anyways.
That's awesome.
So. That's so cool.
Yeah. Last kind of question. Kind of in addition to like the work-life balance, like how is it working with not like specifically your spouse, but like how is it working with a spouse, but then like also, you know, going home with them and being their spouse, like having that balance of
That's a good question. I mean, at the end of the day, there's nobody else I'd rather work with and build our empire with. Yeah. I mean, he's my forever and my best friend, and like we're looking at, we want to have kids soon, and when they kids turn 18, I want to say, here's a house. Like, I want to build this empire for my family.
That's cool.
To be able to maybe like relax when I have kids. I guess I'm working like a dog now to maybe be able to, you know, have kids, and nobody else is raising my kids. I want to raise them. I want to be at every game, etc. So I keep that in the back of my mind when I work with him. But we are so different, but the balance is good.
Yeah.
But you butt heads quite often.
Sure.
Because, I mean, with other people, you might be more reserved of what you're thinking. And, like, if my husband are like, you fucking idiot, no.
There's just no filter.
Correct. Like, yes. But you see both different sides of things, and you have the same end goal in mind.
Right.
So I think at the end of the day, out of anybody, I'd rather work with my husband.
Yeah.
But it's not always the easiest.
Right. Of course.
How do you get so much energy to do all this stuff? To be up so early, to work nonstop all the way to, like, what's the secret?
I don't have a secret. I'm just crazy. Like, I am on the go 24/7. I'm always fired up. I drink a lot of coffee. But that's just my mentality. Yeah. Like, for anything, even growing up, I played college basketball. Like, I was always the crazy one. It was just in my blood.
Do you have problems falling asleep?
Yes. it's hard to turn off the brain.
Right. Yeah. Especially if you have so much going on,
too. Oh, my God, I forgot to do this. Or, oh, my God, this. And I'm like, stop. Oh,
I should do this tomorrow. I should do this.
Yes. Like, or, yeah.
I find myself pulling out, like, I'll be lying in bed, and I'll just have a notes app the next morning of, like, all the stuff I thought of lying in bed.
Yeah.
Like, I got to do this tomorrow, this tomorrow, this tomorrow.
Yes. Yeah. Before I go to bed, I like to scroll on TikTok, which has absolutely nothing to do with, like, work or anything. But that's, like...
That's your mindless,
That's my mind. Time. Yes. Like, 15 minutes before I go to bed, I'm like, oh, what's going on TikTok?
Yeah. Like, kind of calm you down a little
calm
bit.
Calm me down to then fall asleep. Yeah, yes.
Yeah, last thing I would just say is what kind of advice would you give to anybody looking to break into real estate? Like 1 to 3 pieces of advice.
Just jump in. Like, stop thinking about doing it. You need to do it. If you're looking for investment properties, you need to be working with an agent who invests themselves. If you're looking to become a realtor, do your research. Go check out different brokerages. See where you feel best fit. Of course, I'd love for you to work with me at Burns Real Estate Group, and I'll teach you and take you under my wing. However, like, do yourself justice. Yeah. Any brokerage, if you want to be an agent, wants you, okay? Because you're going to make them money. But it's where do you see the best fit? Where do you think you're going to grow the most? Who's actually going to help you, or where are you just going to be a number? So I would say that. And find a mentor, no matter if it's in real estate, if it's in market, like, find somebody who you look up to, who's doing bigger, better things than you are, and learn from them. Because if they're doing it, so can you.
That's cool. That's awesome. Love it.
And you guys are licensed all over, or is it?
Mass, Connecticut, Rhode Island, Florida, and I am in the process of New Hampshire.
Cool.
I'm in that testing process, so. Yeah.
There you go. That's a good, that's a big area.
Yeah,
I feel like you can make a killing on Airbnbs in New Hampshire with the mountains and everything. Clean up.
Yes. The only thing is with the Airbnbs, we like to be relatively close. God forbid we ever have to
go there
run
for
there.
Something. Yeah.
But that's when building a team will be helpful and not doing it all ourselves.
Right. And then just tell people where they can find more about you, your Instagram and... Yeah.
You can find more about me at Brooke Coughlin on Instagram or Facebook, Brooke Coughlin too. And since I got married, it's like a identity crisis. I'm also Brooke Packard. Maybe you'll find me on there too. But just Brooke Coughlin Packard on all social media.
Cool. Awesome. Hope everybody enjoyed. Guys, go give Brooke a follow. Check out her page. Look at some of her houses and learn more about Brooke. And follow us on Instagram at Up In Your Biz Pod. Stay tuned for the next episode.